Good afternoon. And we're here to discuss politics and the future of the American dream today. And there's no better person we could have than Frank Luntz discussing these issues. But I thought, Frank, maybe we ought to discuss first what the American dream is. And this term, the American dream, really was defined in 1931 with the publishing of a book called The Epic of America, as the dream of a land in which life should be better and richer and fuller for everyone, with opportunity for each according to ability or achievement. And so for me, the American dream obviously is a right to economic freedom, a right to upward mobility, not based on who your parents are or where you went to school or whether you're a man or a woman or what your religion is or what your race is. And for me, I switched to finance, and after the Watts riots that occurred here in Los Angeles in 65, when I met a young African-American man who told me he would not have a chance of economic freedom, economic opportunity because of his race. And before we go there, Frank, I thought I'd run one more short clip of Maya Angelou. A number of years ago, as part of a major project we're working on and others, we're filming 10,000 people on what they think the American dream is from every country in the world who's come here. Maya Angelou was filmed as part of an effort on the American dream and the media. So here's her short video.
What is dreamed in America is really no different than what is dreamed in Shanghai. It's the same dream dreamed in Cairo and Johannesburg. Everybody in the world wants a good job. Everybody in the world wants to be loved. Everybody who wants children wants healthy children, wants safe streets. Everybody wants to be able to count on good health care. Every living person. And everybody wants someplace, if he or she is religious, to propitiate God on Saturday or Sunday. And everybody wants a place to party on Saturday night. That is the dream. That is the dream. Oh, why can't I? It may be, in fact, utterly impossible to be successful without helping another person to become successful. I don't know, but I don't think one can be liberated without liberating somebody else. I don't think so. My concern is not just about surviving. I will not live at any cost. But my attempt is to do better than just survive, but to thrive. And to thrive with some passion, some compassion, some humor, and some style.
So, Frank, the concept of economic freedom is important to the American dream. The concept of equal opportunity is important to the American dream. And I know you've been very focused on this issue, the challenges in America we face today. And as Maya Angelou pointed out, this isn't the American dream, and it's the dream around the world. It's the South African dream where I was just, and others. So. But language and how you say something is so important, and I don't think there's anyone else in the world with your skills in this area. So take us down this journey.
Well, I know I'm at a financial conference when she talks about partying on Friday night and nobody here laughs.
No, partying on Saturday night.
Saturday night. Okay, so you know that I'm a geek because I got the date wrong. It's the challenge right now, and it is a challenge, and I'm so glad to be here because your industry leaders, your financial leaders, your economic leaders, and this matters. What we saw last night was the expression for some people of what the American dream is or should be, which is that essence of opportunity. But there's a threat, and I don't know what side you're on, and I want to show you that it is bipartisan. You asked me, what do I want to get out of this? And when I leave here, I hope that there's a sense of civility and decency and respect, because that does not exist in the public right now. I was at a public restaurant this morning, and a host from MSNBC came up and started yelling at me very loudly and called me evil. And this is the kind of conversation that we are having right now. And this is not the American dream. The American dream was about respect and decency and civility. This is a great country, not because of its constitution, but because of its people, and because of how we treat each other, and because we've always been a beacon for the world. And now we're so angry, and we think justified, because our politicians do it to each other, so we now do it to each other. And I want to show you a video, 1 minute of Donald Trump and 1 minute of Michelle Obama, both sides. This is called instant response. We have tested the language of economic freedom, which I will provide to you shortly. But this is a video that shows you that talking about the American dream and doing so in a nonpartisan, non-political way, Donald Trump can get a positive reaction from Democrats. Michelle Obama can get a positive reaction from Republicans. The higher the lines climb, the more favorable the reaction. If it gets up to 80 or higher, it's brilliant. The red line are Republicans, the green line are Democrats. People turn their dials based on what they hear. Let's roll Trump and Michelle together.
We want every American to know the dignity of work, the pride, the beautiful pride, getting a paycheck, the satisfaction of being told that was a job well done. We want every parent to be able to care for their children, and we want every child to know a home filled with love and a community filled with hope.
If our parents and grandparents could toil and struggle for us, you know, if they could raise beams of steel to the sky, send a man to the moon, connect the world with the touch of a button, then surely we can keep on sacrificing and building for our own kids and grandkids, right? And if so many brave men and women could wear our country's uniform and sacrifice their lives for our most fundamental rights, then surely we can do our part as citizens of this great democracy to exercise those rights. Surely we can get to the polls.
You can stop there. Every and all is the key to this. Every person, everywhere, all people, no matter who they are, it's something that you mentioned. And if you can pull up one more slide, that slide that you had up, this is the language. And I invite you, if you want to take a picture of it, because this is language of perfection. This is language of economic freedom. It is not capitalism. Capitalism reminds people of profit over people. It reminds people of Wall Street, not Main Street. I recognize that most people in this room are capitalists, but the phrase itself has been demonized, and it is impossible in the year 2020 to win over the public for capitalism, but you can win them over for economic freedom. And I'll do four of these phrases. The word imagine is the most powerful word in the English language. You ask people to imagine life at perfection, imagine the opportunity that America provides. If they imagine it, they will believe it, they will think that they can achieve it, and they will come over. Second, peace of mind. It is not security. Security means that you need a gun or a fence or a dog or something to protect you. Peace of mind means that you are beyond that. You can close your eyes, in fact, drift away because life is going to be good. The public desperately wants a government that is more efficient, more effective, and more accountable. For those of you who engage in any kind of public service, more efficient so you can do more with less, more effective so you don't do what you cannot do well, and more accountable so you're held responsible for the things that you say and things that you do. Third is mission and commitment. Companies have a mission. That's the purpose of why they exist. A commitment is something that is personal, human, and individual. And one of the greatest problems with people in the financial world is that they don't humanize, personalize, and individualize their communication. And finally, fact-based. It is not evidence-based. Is anyone here a lawyer? If a lawyer raises your hands, get out. You guys are the worst communicators. If it's evidence, then it's for the prosecution or the defense. There are multiple sides of evidence. There is only one factor. There can be numerous facts, but it's not on both sides. You live with statistics all your life. Take a fact-based approach to what you do, not evidence-based.
So, Frank, you know, as I've seen these things evolve just in my own life, I had them be able to create an individual who's the antithesis of everything I believe in, everything I've done with the media. And that was in the 80s. Today, what I see is the wealthiest person in a city was the person that owned the newspaper and most powerful. Now, generally, the poorest person in a city is the person that owns the newspaper. From that standpoint, there's 1,000 news outlets. And if I get paid based on the number of hits I get, I have to create a headline, I have to create something that's shrill in order to get people to come and hit. When I had financed CNN, I can't tell you how people used to make fun of it at ABC or NBC or CBS until they were disintermediated by CNN. But when people think, what was the average viewership of CNN? 0.5%, maybe 1% if there wasn't, but it was extremely valuable. The search engines and everything at Google, Facebook today are set to reinforce what you believe in. So they're going to give you more and more of what you believe in. They're not going to give you the other side to look at.
Can I add something to
that? And I'm going to finish. Today, if someone asked, what is Fox News? What percent of the viewership is Fox News? Unless there's something major going on, an election or something, you're just talking about a couple percent. But today, with the cutting the cord, Fox News is the most profitable cable network in this country, more than ESPN. And MSNBC that you entered, by becoming off the rails, shrill, okay, they increase their viewership and their profitability. So by narrow casting to a small percentage of people, you became more profitable. How does that play in your effort here to get us to be civil?
Well, MSNBC is the only news network with more letters in its name than viewers. So let me. So I actually told that joke live on the air in 2008, and I got fired, but my father was so proud of me that he bought me a car. MSNBC has made a decision, they made a choice, and CNN has followed them, that they get more ratings if they promote Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders, not Joe Biden, and certainly not Mike Bloomberg. And MSNBC has succeeded or established itself as an identity by, and this is one of the reasons why Chris Matthews lost his job, because he said something about Sanders. Now understand that Bernie Sanders is so old it takes him 1.5 hours to watch 60 Minutes. Okay, let me try this. He's so old, his favorite painting is The Last Supper. If you look carefully, he's the second waiter from the left. He's so old, the only time he doesn't have to pee is when he's peeing. I wanted to be secretary. I'm going to keep going until you smile. I wanted to be Secretary of Agriculture in the Sanders administration so that I could plant those magic trees where all that free shit grows from. Okay, one of these has to work. The last time you smiled was when Bernie Sanders was at Ford's Theater with Lincoln to see that wonderful play. The challenge that you face right now is that the politicians are hostile to you. The politicians are hostile to your industry. They're hostile to how you make money. They're hostile to what you collect. And the challenge, which is why I put that slide up, and if you can go back to the next slide, just one more.
Business leaders, you want to go to that one?
If you call yourself a CEO, only 14% prefer it. 86% prefer business leader. So I've actually talked to the CEOs about this, because a CEO deals with a balance sheet, and a business leader has to deal with the problems of society just by changing a word. Can you put up the next slide, actually? Why do these politicians or people talk about jobs, and why don't they talk about careers? Watch this. By a show of hands, how many of you, if I asked you, do you have a job or career, how many of you have a job? Raise your hands. How many of you have a career? Raise your hands. This is what everybody wants. And yet the politicians talk about jobs. It's very frustrating. One more, please. No, everybody doesn't win. You know this from sports. You know this from the Academy Awards and the Emmys. Everyone who's nominated doesn't win, but everybody can benefit. When you talk about no one cheats, that's the negative. Everyone follows the rules is the positive. The idea of opportunity beats a level playing field. The level playing field, nobody really knows what that is. Put the word opportunity in any communication, and the public backs you. And Mike, one of the ones I think is most important, which is not here, the difference between human capital and human talent. If you talk about human capital, you're putting a price tag on your employees. But if you talk about human talent, you're promoting them, you're respecting them. This language really does matter.
So, Frank, I was in New York on 9/11. At the time, I was partners with Larry Ellison in one of our businesses, and I was scheduled to give a talk at Deutsche Bank, which was across the street from the World Trade Centers. And Larry was late, and we pushed the talk back a couple hours, and we never made it downtown. And so, after that was over, we have this National Educator Award, which we started in the mid-80s. And I traveled around the country at that time, Frank, traveling around the country, Toledo, Ohio, Lincoln, Nebraska. And what I saw in many ways was the strength of the United States. These assemblies, there was more patriotic songs, but it still was the high school football game on Friday night. More people were going to church on Sunday morning, and it was their family. So one of the things, is it the coast? Is it 50 miles, is it New York and Los Angeles and San Francisco that are frustrated that the rest of the country is not listening to them, is not doing what they want them to believe in? And what I saw, and when I travel the country, I really see a different country than I would see that the newspapers are reporting and what people believe. So when you say this and you feel this, is it the media, which has never accepted the fact that Trump was elected from the day he was elected? Or is it the country? Are you talking about Los Angeles and New York and Chicago or San Francisco, or are you talking about America?
So it's dangerous now to tell a political joke. You get into trouble. I'm sure that there are three or four of you who are mad at me because I told a couple of Bernie Sanders jokes. I was in the White House for the Christmas party, and I finally got the guts to ask the president, what does the J in Donald J. Trump stand for? You know what he told me? Genius. This is my best material, dude. The best I got is half a corner of a smile. You can't do that anymore. And that's not the America that I know. But it's not just the media. It's Hollywood and academia, and think about it. The media controls our knowledge, academia controls our learning and the next generation, and Hollywood controls the culture. And they're contributing to this sense of alienation. And I'm actually not focused on the coast, I'm focused on inland. Because in the end, I'm looking at Americans who feel ignored or forgotten. And that's the reason why Trump won. I know that there are Democrats in this room. And I say to you, if you want to win in 2020, you have to focus on that sense of alienation. Union members voted for Trump at a higher percentage than any Republican since 1984. Why? Because they thought the Democrats weren't listening to them or weren't fighting for them. That even though Trump lost suburban women by more than any other Republican, he picked up white men in their 50s and 60s who did not have retirement savings, who were nervous about the future, who felt that they had been promised things that were not delivered. And that's why he was able in Michigan, in Pennsylvania, North Carolina, Florida, Wisconsin. And the one thing I'll tell you about this election is that California, this state right here, I don't know how many of you are from it, it's going to go Democratic by 20 points, maybe even more. And it is possible that the Democrat this time win by 4 or even 5 million votes. But Michigan, and I keep hearing that, I keep thinking, wow, Hillary Clinton's back. In Michigan, in Wisconsin, and in Pennsylvania, Trump runs 3 or 4 points ahead of what he does on the compared to the coasts. So we could have, once again, another election where people feel they are robbed. And that is such a tragedy. When you don't trust your own democracy and you don't trust the economy, then you've lost faith in the future.
Bless you. Frank has given us some challenges in our limited time here. And I thought we have spent last six years at the Milken Institute working on building this center for advancing the American dream. And we say the word advancing because research has gone on, for example, showing you that if you were born in Salt Lake to the lowest socioeconomic group, you have a 2.5 times better probability to rise to the highest economic group in your lifetime than if you were born in Charlotte. So where you're born determines your opportunity for upward mobility significantly. Just like health, the number one determinant of health is your zip code. So Frank, I want to show a video here, a short couple of minute video of, out of the 1,200 people we have filmed today, we filmed these five young people. Every single one of them came from another country, different countries here. The birth rate in the United States, as many of you are aware, has fallen 70% since the 1950s. We had the least number of children born in America last year in 30 years. And the entire increase in the U.S. population in the last 50 years is due to immigration. Had we not had immigration? So when we talk about how people feel, here are five individuals who were born into the lowest socioeconomic group. Frank had a chance to visit with some of them on Saturday night. And when asked, what is the American dream, this is how they've responded.
I do believe there's something that is the American dream. It's the reason why this country continues to be the destination of choice all over the world. It's a reflection of a hope and an optimism, not just for oneself and have a better career or a better future, but even for the generations that follow.
My parents are from South Korea, so they came here without knowing anybody, without knowing the language, with literally $100 in between them. They used to work 7 days a week, all the weeks of the year. I think there was one day a year that they would take off and really just to close the store that they owned a little bit early. So they had an incredible, very traditionally immigrant work ethic. it arose from this sense of needing to succeed and needing to be financially secure and stable, not just for themselves, but for me as well.
I was the first person in my family not just to go to college, but to become a physician, and then to become a specialist. I don't think that would have been possible in most countries for someone to come from a family of nothing, to be able to graduate from the best medical school in the country. And now I'm the CEO and owner of multi-million dollar companies. And I'm grateful for being able to do that in this country.
When it was time for my college admissions, and you know, people were complaining how competitive it is, how hard it is to get into good schools, and my parents would always remind me, in India it's about, you know, 100 times worse considering the population and the limited opportunities. There are more opportunities here still to this day. I don't think that this dream is uniquely American, but I am very fortunate for what America has given me.
For me, a lot of access to education really does define the American dream. It's not always about being smart. Sometimes it's about having a window opened and realize that there's something on the other side to strive for. And so I think that that's actually where the Milken Scholars Program is an amazing asset. I didn't expect to be involved 30 years later with a program from my high school, and yet my investment is real because the investment is in people.
It really is the aspiration of all human beings to better themselves. And I think that while this country may have afforded us so many opportunities, it's a dream which belongs to humanity. America really is the world's experiment. Ideas and people from all over the world and from all across time have come together here. And so I think that our country, for that reason, has such a great responsibility, because to whom much is given, much is expected.
So Frank, El Salvador, India, Dominican Republic, Nigeria, etc. How do you respond when you see those young people who grew up in the lowest socioeconomic conditions and rose up in this country?
It's my challenge to you all to go into those schools that don't have these opportunities and mentor them, to actually get into the school and teach them about economic freedom, teach them about entrepreneurship, because they're not learning it in the inner city. And I've got one final comment. I don't know how many of you have children or grandchildren between the ages of 12 and 17, but your kids are the most important thing in life, not your career, not your profitability, not your balance sheet, your children. And I'm gonna tell you in order. So I urge you to write it down, because we're gonna walk out of here. These in order are the most likely elements for you to produce children who are happy, healthy, drug-free, and alcohol-free. Number one, how often do you have dinner with them at night? If you're having dinner with them 5 nights a week, that tells them that they're the most important thing in life. If you're having dinner with them 2 nights a week because of your business, you're neglecting them. Number two, how often do they go to religious services? This is not an appeal to take them to church or synagogue, but the fact is, if they believe in God and they're active, they're more likely to respect others and treat themselves better. Number three, how often do you check their homework at night? If you're checking it 4 nights a week, that tells them that their intellectual development is as important as their physical development. Number four, do they tell you the truth where they are on Friday and Saturday nights, and the truth about their friends? Because if they'll lie to you about that, they'll lie to you about anything. Number five, do you take a trip with them for at least a week every year? And you have to leave your cell phone behind, which for you all is probably impossible. But you realize that every time you take out your phone in front of your kids, every time, you're telling them that whoever's on your phone is more important than you. And six, do they participate in a team sport? Because then they realize that they have a responsibility to others, not just themselves. The American dream is so much about the family. Your work at the Milken Institute is so much about the family. That is how to produce happy, healthy, drug-free, alcohol-free children.
So when we look at this issue that's in this debate of capitalism versus socialism today, and we look at millennials and ask them how they feel about this subject, you find 59% of U.S. adults prefer, quote, a capitalist country than a socialist one. 28% of baby boomers would want to live in a socialist country, but 42%, you can see here, want to live in a capitalist country if they're millennials, and 7% would prefer to live in a communist country. So we have been researching this for quite a while. And what experience have millennials had with our financial system makes them feel this way? One is student loans. They've discovered later that, gosh, even if they go bankrupt, they can't get rid of their student loans. And many of them took romance languages and owed a lot of money. Now they're wondering what their job is later. Second, mortgage debt. A lot of people lived in houses they couldn't afford to live in a house. And they remember when someone tried to take their parents' house, and a memory of the global financial crisis when they were younger. So we've been very focused on what is a good experience. And the session which I participated earlier with Earn In was an example of a company that allows you to borrow money at zero interest rates if you need it, and you can give them a tip. It gives you respect. You don't need to go to a pawnbroker, ask your parents for money, or go to a payday lender. And so as you're looking for more financial firms that give people a positive experience, we think we'll get. So, Frank, I want to give you the last word from this standpoint. U.S. Today, under 30, 26% think that their life's going to be better than their parents. Today. And it's interesting when you read in the paper and everything going on in Mexico, when you look at who are just about the most optimistic teenagers in the world, they live in Mexico. 94.7% are optimistic about their future in Mexico. 72.8% believe their conditions are going to improve, and you can compare that to other countries in the world. Frank, you have the last word.
I'm the only thing that's standing between you and lunch, so all I will add is that it is your responsibility to teach the values of civility, decency, and respect. The word respect, the principle behind it, is the number one priority for employees right now. If they feel you respect them and value them, they'll stay with you. Our election system, this is going to be the worst election cycle we've ever had. It doesn't matter who the nominee is. I can tell you that they're both going to tear each other apart. And it's tragic because the country is being torn apart with it. You don't have to participate. You can say to your colleagues, no, we're not going to have that kind of language here. And I do hope you do that. You've been given the blessing of being able to make a nice living. Please extend it to the next generation by teaching them the values that you grew up in. Our democracy is at stake.
Thank you, Frank.
Thank you, Mike.